Hi there, my name is Jean Klopper and I am a surgeon. One of my passions is medical education. In this series of presentations, I'll talk about things surgical. Remember, these presentations are available for continuous professional development points, so I'll leave the description to that down below. In this presentation, I'm going to talk about thyroid nodules. As we do more and more ultrasounds, we discover more and more thyroid nodules. In actual fact, some reports state that up to 70% of all patients will develop thyroid nodules. So in this presentation, I'm going to tell you what to do with this very common diagnosis. Nodules of the thyroid are amongst the most common histological disorders in the human body. Actually, more than 70% of all humans will develop a thyroid nodule or even more than one nodule during their lifetime. This number keeps increasing with ever more sensitive imaging techniques, and the incidence increases with age, and there is definitely this female predominance. Most of these nodules of the thyroid are fortunately benign. This is so in at least 90% of cases, and most patients will never ever be aware of them. Even some small cancers remain subclinical. Now, fear response is triggered in most patients in whom a nodule is detected, and it's our duty, the duty of the clinician, to manage such a finding with great care. With nodules being so common and routinely seen on ultrasound imaging, it is important to know how to manage the patients with a thyroid nodule. We have to look at the different types of nodules. Now, thyroid nodules may be colloid-filled cystic lesions. All the way over on the other side of the spectrum, we find neoplasms. Now, the latter are either benign, those are true monoclonal adenomas or follicular adenomas, or they can be malignant. Now, a combination of cystic and solid nodules are commonly seen, and that happens in multinodular goiters. A nodule can be cystic to a varying degree, from completely cystic, that's a true cyst with an epithelial lining, but that's quite rare, and then also over to only containing a small cystic component. Cysts are usually the results of a degenerative process of the solid component of a nodule. It is a rule of thumb that the malignant potential of a nodule decreases as its cystic component increases. Now, that's relative to the solid component in the nodule. True monoclonal adenomas are the most common solid lesions of the thyroid. Now, these can usually be identified on an ultrasound and on aspiration cytological examination, and they are really benign lesions. Follicular neoplasms, they can either be benign or malignant. Now, cells seen on cytology for both benign and malignant follicular lesions appear similar, and the diagnosis can only be made on histological evaluation of the surgically resected specimen. There are various types of thyroid carcinomas. These include papillary, follicular, Hürtel cell, medullary, and anaplastic carcinomas, as well as primary thyroid lymphomas. Yes, you can also develop a lymphoma in the thyroid. Now, the true proportion of malignant lesions, they're really not known, as it depends on how the incidence of nodules as a whole is described. If we only look at the incidence of clinically discovered nodules, then the incidence of carcinoma is going to be high. But of all true nodules of the thyroid, the incidence is pretty low. Let's look at the risk factors for the development of thyroid nodules. The most common risk factors are advancing age, the female gender, dietary iodine deficiency, and a history of exposure to ionizing radiation, such as radiotherapy of the head and neck. So the most common ones there really age and the female gender. Now, these are not the only factors that put a patient at risk, though. Tobacco smoking, excessive consumption of alcohol, and obesity are risk factors for many diseases, including, unfortunately, also the development of thyroid nodules. Now, the less commonly known risk factors are the presence of uterine fibroids, high insulin growth factor 1 levels, and hematopoietic stem cell transplantation. So some of the rarer risk factors there. Now, thyroid nodules and cancers can be associated with familial disorders, and it is important to inquire about a self or a family history of thyroid disease or cancer, or indeed any endocrine conditions. Remember, multiple endocrine neoplasias, so that's especially types 2A and B, they are associated with medullary thyroid cancer. Now, familial non-medullary thyroid cancer, that's quite rare, and it's really not that well defined. It is known to be associated with Cowden syndrome, familial adenomatous polyposis, Gardner syndrome, Carney complex type 1, Werner syndrome, and Dicer 1 syndrome. So all these very rare conditions. Now, some factors are associated with a decreased incidence of thyroid nodules. So something that decreases the patient's risk of developing a thyroid nodule. Now, these include the use of the oral contraceptive pill and also statins. Now, unfortunately, it's not currently known if these hormone formulations and medications are protective in any way, though. We just know that it is associated with a lower incidence of thyroid nodules. Now, size of the actual lesion, that is a risk factor for malignancy. And the larger they are, especially after about 2 centimeters in greater diameter, it becomes more likely to harbor a carcinoma. Clinical findings. Now, depending on the clinical setting, thyroid nodules are either diagnosed when they become visually evident, so that's visually or through their symptoms, or when seen incidentally during imaging for other conditions, and most notably the common use of ultrasound these days. Now, whilst a visible neck mass is common in some settings and yet others, these nodules are palpable only. So you don't see them by looking at the patient, but can palpate them. Now, some that are large enough, especially those in the periphery of the gland, can cause compressive symptoms involving the erodigestive tract. Now, these compressive symptoms are dysphagia, adynophagia, choking, this feeling of a squeezing sensation in the neck, a globus sensation, that is the sensation of a mass or a lump or a foreign body in the throat that doesn't disappear by swallowing, and then also dyspnea and some voice changes, that subtle voice fatigue in cases of large nodules or actual voice changes due to nerve infiltration by a malignant process. Now, the thyroid gland is visually inspected from in front of the patient, stand in front of the patient, and we make note of any gross enlargements or asymmetry. And then the thyroid moves during swallowing. And remember, all signs should be elicited by asking the patient to swallow. It's difficult when someone just asks you to swallow, so it might be handy just to have a glass of water nearby. Now, bruise and thrills, they are not commonly seen in thyroid nodules, and they really may be indicative of other pathologies such as carotid aneurysms. So watch out for those. Now, the thyroid is palpated from behind the patient, once again asking the patient to swallow, and then a note should be taken of any asymmetry, and also the surface of the thyroid, as well as its size, consistency, location, and the movement of any masses. Depending on the patient habitus and the clinician's experience with examination of the thyroid, the finer changes may be missed. We all miss some of these, the finer changes that you find with these, the appearance of these nodules. Now, at the very least, we can take note of the following rule of thumb. Bilateral enlargement with a smooth surface, that's indicative of a goiter, that's iodine deficiency or even Graves' disease. A unilateral enlargement is indicative of a nodule. So just feel that one side is bigger than the other. That's probably a nodule. And then an irregular surface in a normal-sized or an enlarged thyroid, that's indicative of a multinodular goiter. So that's just this rule of thumb. And then nodules that are rock-hard and immobile, that means they fix to the surrounding structures, that should raise the suspicion of a malignancy. Now, malignancy can metastasize to regional lymph nodes. We think about papillary thyroid carcinomas. And also the jugular chain, and we should really palpate these to feel for nodes. Now, the famous Pemberton sign that you might remember, that involves venous jugular engorgement, facial plethora, and even dyspnea when the patient lifts their arms. That's the Pemberton sign. Well, we don't see that commonly, but it's worthwhile to remember. Now, that's caused by severe compressive symptoms due to a large retrosternal goiter. What about thyroid function tests? We all send off our patients off to the lab to get thyroid function tests. Now, we really have to make a special note of this. Most nodules are hormonally inactive, but they can overproduce thyroid hormone in some cases. And yet others, they occur in the setting of hyperthyroidism, such as that caused by Graves' disease, or in the setting of hypothyroidism, such as caused by Hashimoto's thyroiditis. So we really have to be on the lookout for thyroid nodules in all of these, in these cases. Now, a thyroid nodule in a hyperthyroid patient, that necessitates the use of a scintigram. And that's to determine whether it's the nodule causing the overproduction or the underlying thyroid itself. So, yeah, send away for your thyroid function tests. So how do we work up these patients? Well, the absolute minimum workup after discovering any thyroid nodule includes a thyroid-stimulating hormone level. That's number one. and then a thyroid ultrasound. And then further workup is determined by the results of these two investigations. So thyroid function test and an ultrasound. Logistic regression analysis through research that's shown that patients with a normal TSH level, those with their level just close to the upper end, that's about 1.7 millimeters per liter, they have a higher odds ratio of malignancy than those that are still normal but at the lower end of normal. So just something to remember. So in the case of a suppressed TSH level, that's hyperthyroidism, overactive thyroid, we do a thyroid scintigram with a radioactive iodine isotope. Now, the possible reporting will either be that of a hot nodule or a warm nodule or a cold nodule. And the warm and cold ones, their follow-up is the same as someone with a normal TSH level. So those with a hot nodule, we don't really do any further workup for them because carcinoma, just at least for investigating the possibility of a cancer, it's very rare to have a hyperfunctional thyroid carcinoma. Now, these patients with their hot nodules, they are further evaluated for radioactive iodine therapy or surgery. And then this includes the pretreatment of an antithyroid medication to manage their hyperthyroidism. And unless there's a contraindication to surgery, a thyroid lobectomy and isthmus resection in the case of unilateral disease or total thyroidectomy in the case of bilateral disease, that has a very high cure rate for this overactive nodule. Now, hyperthyroidism, that recurs then in less than 3% of cases following a lobectomy and unilateral disease. But in the case of radioactive iodine therapy, if the patient chooses that, that has a higher recurrence rate. About 1 in 5 will have recurrence of their hyperthyroidism. Now, up to a half of patients, they will also develop hypothyroidism within 10 years after the therapy. So we have to follow these patients up long term. So then let's look at the patients that are euthyroid or are hypothyroid. So they now go for the workup because we need to determine whether this nodule is malignant or not. Now, the findings on ultrasound. Ultrasound is our first investigation. The findings on ultrasound are classified by the American College of Radiologists using the Thyroid system. And you get this kind of system now for many possible lesions in the body. Now, the aim of the imaging classification system, that's to reduce the incidence of biopsies on lesions that are highly unlikely to be of clinical significance. So we have this classification system from our radiology colleagues because we really don't want to overdo things, just to take unnecessary biopsies and just increase the cost and the stress to the patient. We have the Thyroid system here. We look at the radiologists will look at a few things, the composition, the echogenicity, the transverse plane shape, the margins, and the echogenic foci in this lesion. And points are given for those. Those are then tallied, and we get the result. What we have is a Thyroid's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And a Thyroid's 1, that's really a benign. 2 is a non-suspicious lesion. 3 is mildly suspicious. 4 is moderately suspicious, and 5 is then highly suspicious. So for benign, we don't do any further workup. There's no fine needle aspiration cytology required, and also for a Thyroid's 2. For a mildly suspicious lesion, that's type 3, we can really follow that patient up for a year, year 1, year 3, and year 5, and that is if the lesion is less than 25 millimeters in greatest diameter. If it's more than 25 millimeters in greater diameter, we do a fine needle aspiration cytology. When we get to moderately suspicious, that's Thyroid 4, we also follow the patient up on years 1, 3, and 5, and that's for lesions less than 15 millimeter. If they're 15 millimeter or more, fine needle aspiration cytology. When it comes to Thyroid 5, if the lesion is less than a centimeter in greatest diameter, we can do a follow-up of these lesions. They're small, and we're not sure of their clinical significance. And if they are greater than a centimeter, though, they get fine needle aspiration as well. So that's how we use the Thyroid system. So let's look at the fine needle aspiration cytology. That is performed under ultrasound guidance, and we use a small 25 or 22 or 27 gauge needle, and that's inserted right into the lesion. And then the findings are reported by our pathology colleagues using the Bethesda system for reporting thyroid cytopathology. And there are 6 classes described using this Bethesda system. Now, a class 1, that class identifies samples that are not amenable to psychological examination. We see that you put the needle in and it's unfortunately a bloody aspirate, and we can't make a diagnosis on that. There's just inadequate sampling. It is also seen when lesions are particularly cystic. Sometimes it's impossible to obtain a good sample. In the case of the latter, clinical judgment must be used to decide between a lobectomy and interval observation. And we usually do that according to the thyroids then and to according to the size. Now, most cases, a repeat aspiration will need to be done, and it usually yields a proper sample. Now, it's best to do this in the setting then where the aspirate can immediately be examined in the presence of a pathologist where they can look for adequate follicular cells. So sit by the patient and we take those final aspiration cytology, have it looked at immediately, not to make the diagnosis, but just to make sure that there are follicular cells that can be examined. Now, remember, it is advised that 3 months pass before repeating the final aspiration. So you can't just do it the next week. Unless there's a very high suspicion of malignancy, then we can do it sooner. But it is advised to have 3 months in between those final aspirations. For class two, that's clearly benign pathology in an adequate sample. And then that's the most common diagnosis then is that of a benign colloid nodule with benign appearing follicular cells and an abundance of colloid. So there's this colloid cell ratio, and the more colloid with adequate cells, that really tells us that it's benign. Now, care should be taken to ensure that the sample was representative, that it wasn't taken outside of the nodule, because there's a false negative rate. And then the American Thyroid Association, they advise that all patients should have a follow-up ultrasound within the following year to document growth, even if it is this Bethesda 2. So growth, we define that as an increase of 20% in at least two dimensions. So the repeat aspiration for cytology should be done in all cases of growth, as well as in cases with a new compressive symptoms or visual enlargement or appearance of new nodules. Then we're going to do it in FNA again. Again, if there's no growth identified, and we can just repeat the ultrasound examination with an interval of about 2 years. It must be remembered, though, that benign lesions can actually grow too. So you might repeat those biopsies and it is again, it's again benign, even though they've grown. So for class three, that's either cellular atypia or a follicular lesion with undetermined significance. So those are both class three. Now, the incidence of carcinoma in this class is unknown, since most of these cases do not come to surgery. We don't operate them. And the true rate of malignancy is therefore unknown. A repeat aspiration for cytology is one possible choice. Now, if the class diagnosis persists, then we'll do a lobectomy. We should really consider a lobectomy, an isthmus resection then. And in advanced areas, we get molecular testing these days. It's becoming more widely available. And if it is, we'll do that for classes 2 to 5. So if Bethesda 4, that is a follicular neoplasm. That the sheets of follicular cells that's seen with a paucity of colloid. So there's many more cells, so the cellular colloid ratio that goes in the favor of being much more cellular. Now, the malignant potential of a follicular neoplasm, we can't see that on cytology because the architecture, the cellular architecture, or the tissue architecture, I should say, is not preserved with a final aspiration. Now, we really need that architecture, the tissue architecture, in the evaluation because we need to look for infiltration to make this a follicular carcinoma. And how to manage these? Well, exactly the same as class 3. When we get to class 5, that's really suspicious of a malignancy, and surgical resection is really advised. Now, for lesions less than 4 centimeters, without lymph node enlargement or any high-grade pathological findings, we can do just a lobectomy and isthmus resection, but in all other cases, we'll do a total thyroidectomy. A sixth, then, it's very clearly malignant, and these include papillary carcinomas. It's you can diagnose papillary thyroid cancer on a final aspiration. You don't need the tissue architecture. Now, it must be noted that surgery can proceed irrespective of a low Bethesda class. Patients with benign disease may not be able to live with the compressive symptoms, or they may prefer surgery for cosmetic reasons. Now, it's important to discuss the possible complications of subtle or more profound voice changes due to nerve injury and the risk of hypothyroidism with all the patients so that they can make an informed decision that is best for them. It is just as important to consider patient comorbidities, both current and future, and it might be prudent to operate before comorbidities naturally worsen with age and a higher incidence of developing with age. So we really got to take all these things in consideration and discuss these with the patient so they can make a decision that is really best for them. Now, the guidelines are really unclear as to how long to follow up a patient with benign final aspiration cytology. And then many are seen yearly with repeat ultrasounds and aspiration biopsies. And they might just become sick of the situation, and they might decide on surgery as well. Now, what to do with these cystic lesions? Now, as we've mentioned, some nodules are predominantly cystic in nature. Most of them form from degenerating adenomas. They just degenerate, and the majority are benign. Although malignant cystic lesions, they do exist. They're rare, but they do exist. Now, purely cystic lesions do not require final aspiration. You see an ultrasound, you can clearly see that this is a cystic lesion, and you don't really need a final aspiration cytology of that. Now, you can aspirate the cyst to dryness if they are large and they have compressive symptoms. The patient has compressive symptoms. Now, the aspirate, we do send that for cytological evaluation, and the results are managed accordingly. Now, cysts that recur after repeated aspiration or remain present after aspiration, especially if they're symptomatic, pain or compressive symptoms, that can be managed by surgical lobectomy. Fortunately, there's not many of those patients, but we really can consider the surgery in this setting. Now, the same can be said for cysts that are a diagnostic dilemma. We get these mixed solid cystic nodules, and in those cases, they just manage them as if they are just purely solid nodules. So in conclusion, then, thyroid nodules are commonly seen in all our medical practices. Now, patients should be investigated, number one, for hyperthyroidism. That's the number one. So you send away your TSH if that's low, that's hyperthyroid patient. And they should undergo scintigraphy. If it's a hot nodule, they require lobectomy. And if it's warm or cold nodule, they just treat it the same as the euthyroid or hypothyroid patients. Now, in those that are then euthyroid or hypothyroid, they get an ultrasound. And based on that, they'll get a final aspiration cytology. And then we decide between surveillance and surgery. And then the highly suspicious ultrasound or cytology classes, they are managed by surgical resection. And careful follow-up is really planned in all other cases. So your thyroid patient really stays with you, and you do follow them up over a long period of time, as with most thyroid diseases. The thyroid or pathology of the thyroid changes with time, and we need to monitor those patients. Please remember that this video series is part of a program of continued medical education, and the information for that will also be in the description down below.